This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
It's Samrat on the outside, Uncle Si in between horses, In Trouble is down at the rail. The three of them are heads apart as they come for the quarter pole in the Gotham. In Trouble at the rail, Samrat on the outside, Uncle Si battles on in between horses. Three quarters went in one, 12-1. And it's Samrat and Uncle Si, and Samrat, Uncle Si, and In Trouble. Three of them are right together as they come down for the 16th pole. Samrat, Uncle Si, In Trouble. None of them giving way. They come down for the finish line. It's Samrat narrowly, and Samrat will stay undefeated. Samrat over Uncle Si, and In Trouble, the three of them battled the length of the stretch in the Gotham.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Down the Stretch. I'm Mark Casano. On this morning's very busy show, plenty of news coming out of Saratoga. During our three-year-old segment, a serious injury to Top Billing, foot problems for others, a doozy in the Gotham, and an updated Derby Dozen. Then we will be joined by four very special guests. From Southern California, Mr. Art Sherman and Kathy Ritvo, and from South Florida, Mr. Eddie Plesa and Mr. Mark Casse. So all of that and much, much more if you stay with us for this, our March 8th edition of the program. Good morning. Welcome once again. If you were watching the end of Handicapper's Report, you heard Anthony mention a very serious injury to Top Billing. We are trying to get a hold of Shug McGahee to get more information, but it appears to be a very serious fracture and in all likelihood the end of his racing career. Any news we get from Shug, we will pass that along to you later in the show. Now, on Friday, 10 finalists for the Hall of Fame were announced, with seven of them being carryovers from last year's ballot. As you take a look, the three new names are Curlin, the 2007 and 2008 Horse of the Year in his first year eligible for the Hall of Fame, his trainer Steve Asmussen, who was actually eligible last year but didn't make the ballot, and Kona Gold, winner of the 2000 Breeders' Cup Sprint, champion sprinter that year. I don't mind telling you, I'm a little surprised by Kona Gold, because there were a number of horses, past Horses of the Year, a near Triple Crown winner in Smarty Jones, who were eligible that didn't make the ballot. So Kona Gold does surprise me. Now, as you take a look at those 10 names, as a voter, I can vote for as many of those finalists as I deem Hall of Fame worthy. The top four vote getters will earn induction into the Hall of Fame on August 8th. Now, I have spoken to you for years about this. In my opinion, there continues to be a problem when you predetermine, in this case four, the number of Hall of Fame worthy individuals or horses. I mean, you know, baseball last year had nobody go into the Hall of Fame. That was okay. So Cooperstown lost a weekend. But here in racing, they deem that every year four are going to go in, and I got to tell you, folks, you can't predetermine Hall of Fame worthiness. Some years you might have none, you might have one, other years you might have seven or eight, but that's the way racing does it, and in my opinion, again, I think it's created a bit of a problem. The New York Racing Association made some Saratoga news this past week as it announced nearly $2 million worth of improvements for Saratoga Racecourse. 750 new high-definition televisions, 500 in the backyard area alone, 250 inside the clubhouse and grandstand and the clubhouse boxes, large video walls in the paddock, the outdoor bays and the carousel, 125 new picnic tables, an enhanced sound system, which, folks, is long overdue. an expanded kids area in the backyard, updated greater capacity for Wi-Fi, upgraded bathrooms, which is certainly long overdue. Trackus will make its debut at Saratoga this summer. On the porch in the clubhouse, the dining room area, apparently that's going to be expanded to create better views. And very soon, the New York Racing Association will officially announce purse increases for Saratoga. They have done studies, and we will find out very soon what kind of purse increases await for this year's Saratoga meet. Three-year-old segment. Again, the recent news that top billing, one of the top three-year-olds of this year, and pointing for the Florida Derby, has incurred a fracture. And again, if we get any additional news from Shug McGahee, we will pass that along. Other three-year-old news, Bayern, who would have started as the likely favorite in today's San Felipe, has been scratched due to a bruised quarter. Trainer Bob Baffert said the injury is minor, but the timing certainly isn't. He will either train to the Santa Anita Derby or ship out of town, depending on how quickly the injury heals. And Havana, who was a late scratch from last Saturday's Swale, which was to be his 2014 debut, has a quarter crack problem he's dealing with. The missed time really puts him behind the eight ball since he hasn't run in 4 months. And Mexicoma, who was a late running third in his three-year-old debut a couple of weeks ago over a very speed-favoring Gulfstream strip, spiked a fever recently and has missed some training time. His next start is undecided at this time. So how about some good news? Sweet Reason, one of the better two-year-old fillies of 2013, made her three-year-old debut yesterday at Aqueduct for Leah Giamatti. The winner of Saratoga's Grade 1 Spinaway, Sweet Reason had to work to win a one-mile allowance race by about a half length. Now, she was wide throughout, was fanned very wide off the last turn. But, you know, each of her four rivals in there were eligible for a condition lower than Friday's race. I mean, they filled the race, but they filled it with fillies who were eligible for easier spots. Sweet Reason is scheduled to come back pretty quickly in the April 5th Gazelle. Getting back to the three-year-old males for a second, Bondholder, who was withheld from today's Tampa Bay Derby due to a foot abscess. So we've got a lot of foot problems cropping up with Bayern, with Havana, with Bondholder. And you know what? It happens every year about this time. Now, the major three-year-old race of the week passed, the mile and a 16th Gotham in New York, featuring a rematch of the Withers battle between Samrat and Uncle Cy. Different from the Withers was the substantially stronger supporting cast in the Gotham. Samrat number 1A was the 2-1 favorite, and Uncle Cy number 4 was the 7-2 second choice. There was number 10, Harpoon, coming off a nose loss in the Sam Davis. He was the 4-1 third choice. And the unbeaten In Trouble for one of last week's guests, Tony Dutrow, he being number 2, was the 9-2 fourth choice. There was also the lingering question of how much that hard Withers battle, when Samrat and Uncle Cy went head-and-head for the entire race, how much that might have taken out of each of those colts. So for the call of the Gotham, here's John Imbriel.
And they're off. Financial Mogul and In Trouble, In Trouble, makes the early lead. Uncle Cy now moves up. On the outside is a Samrat. And Deceived is there in fourth as they race for the clubhouse turn. In Trouble on top here with Uncle Cy giving chase in second. Samrat's on the outside, deceives in between horses. Financial Mogul is down at the rail and racing in fifth. Then comes Noble Cornerstone and Harpoon. They're right together. At the back are Master Lightning and Extra Sexy Hipster. They've reached the backstretch after an opening quarter mile in 23 4/5 seconds. In trouble by a head. Uncle Cy pressuring that pace in second. Samrat is running in third. Then it's Deceived, along with Noble Cornerstone. Financial Mogul is sixth, but just 3 lengths from the lead. Then it's Extra Sexy Hipster. On the far outside is Harpoon. And Master Lightning trails in ninth, the half mile, in 48 1/5 seconds. In trouble, Uncle Cy. They're 1-2 as they go around the far turn. And Samrat now makes a move right alongside of the front two. It's Samrat on the outside. Uncle Cy in between horses. In Trouble is down at the rail. The three of them are heads apart as they come for the quarter pole in the Gotham. In Trouble at the rail. Samrat on the outside. Uncle Cy battles on in between horses. Three quarters went in one. 12-1. And it's Samrat and Uncle Cy and Samrat. Uncle Cy and In Trouble. Three of them are right together as they come down for the 16th pole. Samrat, Uncle Cy, In Trouble. None of them giving way. They come down for the finish line. It's Samrat narrowly, and Samrat will stay undefeated.
Samrat, able to set a perfect outside stalking trip, wears down a game Uncle Cy between horses and a resilient In Trouble on the fence to score a neck victory in the Gotham and remain unbeaten in 5 career starts. Now, the post position draw had just about everything to do with the way the Gotham unfolded. Breaking from the inside and being fresh off a lengthy layoff, In Trouble, as expected, took the early lead. Uncle Cy, having broken from post 3, was quickly sent up after the pace, while Samrat, after having broken from outside of his two main rivals, was able to secure the ideal stalking trip on the outside. Now, Samrat, you know, while he sat the best trip of the three, he did give both rivals some weight. He gave 5 pounds to Uncle Cy and 3 pounds to In Trouble. And he rated very kindly throughout. Although, you know, let's face it, it's much easier to rate while outside of horses. Uncle Cy found himself in between rivals for much of this trip, a somewhat difficult place to be, and certainly coming down the stretch. He continued on well after feeling pressure from Samrat on the outside and yielded grudgingly late. In Trouble, after sneaking away very early from the inside post, came under pressure throughout. Now, while making his two-turn debut off a lengthy layoff and then racing inside under pressure throughout, I thought that was a very solid effort. It's pretty apparent now that the Withers battle between Samrat and Uncle Cy moved these statebreds forward. After a tough race like that, some horses will regress while others move forward, and they certainly moved forward. The Gotham pace was pretty steady, as well as contested. 23:35, 48:30, 1:12:30, 1:37:56, with a final running time of 1:44.44, being 0.6 seconds faster than Team Pauline ran in winning the top flight a half hour earlier. It appears as though Samrat, Uncle Cy, and In Trouble will all come back for the Wood Memorial, where the waters will likely get quite a bit deeper. All right, let's take a quick look at our Derby Dozen as of this morning, March 8th. We are only 8 weeks out from the Kentucky Derby. And again, the injury to Top Billing happened a very, very short time ago, while training in South Florida. So obviously he will be off this list as of next week. Havana off the list due to the quarter crack issue. The top three remain the same. I dropped Bayern and Shared Belief due to issues. Samrat debuts on the list at number 11. Cairo Prince will go next in the Florida Derby. Candy Boy will go in the Santa Anita Derby. Honor Code is going to work tomorrow morning, and then he's going to run next Wednesday in the eighth race at Gulfstream, an allowance race which they rode for him, a short field of five. He will use that instead of the Rebel as a prep for the Wood Memorial. Again, top billing is out. Tapator and California Chrome each move up a couple. California Chrome goes in today's San Felipe. Bayern and Shared Belief at 7 and 8. Bayern will train up to the Santa Anita Derby or ship out of town. Shared Belief has not had a workout since January 3rd with those foot issues. Strong Mandate will go in the Rebel. Intense Holiday in the Louisiana Derby. Samrot in the Wood and Conquest Titan will go in this afternoon's Tampa Bay Derby. So there's a quick look at our updated Derby dozen as we stand only 8 weeks out from the first Saturday in May. And we are up to our first break on this morning's show. When we return off to Southern California, where we'll welcome Mr. Art Sherman. As we go to the break, the 7-furlong swale. With the loss of Havana, it left number 3, No Name Never, who had never run on dirt and never run beyond 6 furlongs, as the 2-5 favorite. So we'll take a look at the swale to the break. Back with Art Sherman right after these messages.
They're racing in the swale. No Nay Never goes straight out to take the lead. Prudhoe Bay also with speed. Can't Stop the Kid goes with them from the inside, and these three out for the front. Breitling Flyer is away running in fourth, and then Spot and Brothers of the Time up the back stretch. And it is Can't Stop the Kid in front. No Nay Never, the heavy favorite, is a neck back in second, and just to the outside is Prudhoe Bay, and they went 22-1 for the first quarter. Break of three, and then Breitling Flyer fourth by another 5, and then Spot and Brothers of the Time. Into the turn, Can't Stop the Kid, the leader. No Nay Never still ride alongside with 3 furlongs to go. Prudhoe Bay is a length and a half off of them. Breitling Flyer, Spot, and Brothers of the Time. And there goes No Nay Never to take the lead on the outside from Can't Stop the Kid. Prudhoe Bay is there, and Spot is beginning to move up. Spot is putting in a charge on the far outside after a 44 and 2.5 mile. They're into the stretch. No Nay Never, but Spot is rolling up on the far outside. And here comes Spot and Jose Lescano to take the lead from No Nay Never. And then comes Brothers of the Time. It is Spot in front coming down to the line, and Spot has won the swale. No Nay Never was second, Brothers of the Time third, and Prudhoe Bay was fourth.
This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Missed one of our TV shows? No worries. Now you can catch all your favorite programs online. Simply log on to CapitalOTB.com and click on the YouTube link at the bottom of the homepage. And look for our new podcast coming soon. CapitalOTB.com. Log on today.
Here in upstate New York, no one provides bettors with more wagering options than Capital OTB. Our network of ranch and easy bet locations stretches from the mid-Hudson Valley all the way to the Canadian border and west to central New York. So whether you need to place a bet, fund your Capital Bets account, or watch the next big race, all the action is just around the corner. A full list of our branch and easy bet locations can be found online at CapitalOTB.com. Capital OTB, the better and most convenient choice for wagering in upstate New York.
Welcome back to Down the Stretch, everyone. I'm Mark Asano, and the swale goes to Spot, who runs down No Nay Never to upset by 2.5 lengths. I've really been looking forward to having our first guest on. I mentioned to you back on the show of February 1st that we were going to try to get him on this morning because his colt was going in the San Felipe, and I think he's improving at the right time. The improving colt is California Chrome. His trainer, Mr. Art Sherman. Art, Mark Casano, welcoming you back to Down the Stretch.
Good morning.
Art, let's get right to it. As our audience watches California Chrome capture the King Glorious two back at Hollywood, and for our audience, he's number 8. Art, I recently said on the show that I am convinced that California Chrome has become a more mature and much more professional racehorse in his last two starts. How accurate is that?
Well, he's peaking at the right time. He even went beyond my expectations of how he's been maturing in the last 2 or 3 months. I'll tell you, coming into this race, he's a different horse. He's trained very professional. He worked very good. And I'm looking forward to today. You know, it's a big day. You know, San Felipe's going to be a stepping stone for him to go to the Derby. And I need the points. He gets 50 points. And that would get me into the Derby if you just happened to jump up and get lucky today and win.
Art, what do you attribute his transformation, if you will? What do you attribute that to? Is it simply the maturation process kicking in?
Well, you know, when you got a young horse and he starts thinking he can beat somebody, you know what I mean? It kind of was mind-boggling me to watch him run the last time when he ran at Santa Anita. You know, you think you have a good chance and you know your horse is going to run good without any problems. But the way he did it, you know, it kind of even surprised me. You know, he went like from second stalk of the horse to 5 in front. I just was like, what's going on? I thought he might have moved too quick, but he was just galloping. Victor said he had a lot of horse left, so I was kind of impressed myself, you know what I mean? I said, wow, look at here. You know, I can understand you winning by half a length, you know, and coming on, but he just was pricking his ears 5 in front, you know. I'm saying, wow. It was kind of overwhelming for me, you know, at this point.
Well, we're going to look at that in just a couple of minutes. For now, Art, we're going to put up a shot of California Chrome on the screen for our audience. Please take a minute to describe him for us from a physical standpoint. What's he like?
Well, he's got a lot of chrome. That was a great name for him, the California Chrome. He's got 4 white feet with a big blaze, and he's a chestnut, you know, with kind of that light gleaming chestnut. He really looks pretty, you know what I mean? You can get that dark colored chestnut that is kind of, you know, a nice color, but the gleaming lighter chestnuts, they just, when they peak, they really look good. You know, we were schooling them the other day at Santa Anita, and everybody came up to me and said how good the horse looks.
Well, you know, Art, we watched the King Glorious, and it's one thing for a speed horse to be able to rate and relax in a sprint. It's another thing when you go 2 turns. And here's that 2-turn race, the Cal Cup Derby on January 25th. For our audience, he is number 7 in here. Art, I know you mentioned a couple of minutes ago, this even exceeded your expectations. Talk about this wonderful performance.
Well, you know, he was the kind of horse I said, listen, you know, he's got tactical speed if you want to use it. You know what I mean? And which is good in California. It's such a speed-oriented track, yeah. You know, in California. You know, if you can be in contention turning from home, you got a big chance, you know. But he kind of, when he made that move, you know, coming around the 3A pole and turning for home, I said, well, he looks like he's running comfortable. But then when he opened up, you know, from the quarter pole to the 8th pole, he was 5 in front. I said, well, maybe, you know, the first thing that came to my mind is he might have moved too quick, you know, being an ex-rider. I thought, well, I hope he has horse left. And Victor said he was just galloping when I talked to him after the race.
That's what he said to you, that he was just galloping.
Right. So I was kind of, I said, wow. You know, I said, that's good for 1.25 miles, I can tell you that, down the road.
All right, now, our audience is going to watch this move right now when, really, without Victor asking him, he just inhales the leaders. Victor's ridden him for you in his last 2 starts. Art, what has he said to you about the progression that California Chrome has made?
Well, he says the horse is improving. He's just peaking at the right time, he told me. He says, Art, he says, the horse is getting stronger, and he's smart. You know, he's one of them horses that you know, he's not a nervous type of horse. He brings his everything into the race, you know what I mean? He's got a good demeanor about him. He's good saddling. And, you know, he's kind of like a people's horse. You know, he's very kind around people. He loves the attention, and which he gets all the time, you know. It's just a pleasure to train a horse like him, you know.
That is wonderful. Recently, you've had quite a bit of rain in Southern California. Has that interrupted his training at all?
Well, you know, it hasn't, because I'm over here at Los Alamitos, and, you know, we had that heavy storm, and Mr. Allred, who owns Los Alamitos, and who I have to trade a couple of horses for, you know, they closed the track down, and they opened up the railing on the inside for me, and they just went over backwards, and he worked on a, I guess he really, it wasn't an off track, but he worked like a minute, two fifths, and galloped out in 13-1, you know, which is a super work, you know, for that distance, you know, that day.
One final question, Art. Everybody gets Derby fever to some degree at this time of year. You have never had a starter in the Kentucky Derby. How high is Derby fever running for Art Sherman right now?
Well, you know, I got as far with Lickitill Hill. I made it to the Bluegrass, and I really thought I had a contender there, but he was such a different horse than this one. He was a big-footed horse and almost 17 hands. This horse has got no wasted motion. To me, he's the type of horse that you don't have to carry your track with. You know what I mean? I think he would run on anything. You know, he's run on all kind of surfaces already, and I just think that he's the right kind of horse for the Derby Trail.
Well, Art, first of all congratulations on the successes with California Chrome. Great job to you and your staff. All the best later this afternoon in the San Felipe, and we thank you so much for having joined us this morning on Down the Stretch.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you, Art. Art Sherman, ladies and gentlemen. We are up to our next break. When we return, it's off to South Florida, where we'll welcome in Mr. Eddie Plesa as we go to the break. The Santa Isabel for three-year-old fillies at Santa Anita. 3-2 favorite, number 4, Swiss Lake Yodler. So we'll take a look at the Santa Isabel to the break. Back with Eddie Plesa right after these messages.
And away they go to a good beginning.
Awesome Baby immediately jumps out to the lead. Swiss Lake Yodler settles second. Artemis down at the rail. Be Proud coming up at joint third. Leaves the long shot Saintly Joan at the back, but only 5 lengths would cover them all. Into the turn they go, and Awesome Baby, real easy lead out here, takes them along by a length and a half to Swiss Lake Yodler. Artemis scrapes the paint in third. Up alongside of that comes Be Proud, and last of all is Saintly Joan. 5 covers them all. They head past the three-quarter pole, and Awesome Baby, alone out here, leads it by a length. Artemis gets a little closer in second. Swiss Lake Yodler's a joint second on the far side. Then comes Be Proud, and still the trailer is Saintly Joan, now 6 off the lead. They head to the half-mile pole, and Awesome Baby, still no pressure on the lead. Now Artemis comes to turn the pressure on, and Artemis puts the pressure on Awesome Baby, who has to quicken, but goes clear again. So Awesome Baby glides back into a 2-length lead. Artemis couldn't get up alongside of her. On the far side, we have Swiss Lake Yodler in third. They've been followed by Be Proud, who's now 6 off them, and 3 more to Saintly Joan. They are coming to the top of the lane, and it's still Awesome Baby out in front. Artemis going to make another run at her now. Awesome Baby, Artemis comes back to take her on, but Awesome Baby strong on the lead. Swiss Lake Yodler's back in third. They're at the top of the lane now. Awesome Baby goes on strongly. Artemis is running a brave 1 second. Down the center of the track, Swiss Lake Yodler. But it's Awesome Baby going on. Leads now by 2. Artemis hasn't given up the chase, but can't get to Awesome Baby. Awesome Baby now clear by 3 and coming home to score. Awesome Baby and Mike Smith too good in the Santa Isabel. Artemis was second. Swiss Lake Yodler, Saintly Joan, and Be Proud.
This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Welcome back to Down the Stretch, everyone. I'm Mark Casano. My thanks to Art Sherman once again for having joined us. An awesome baby, Bob Baffert, Mike Smith, wire to wire by 2¾ over Artemis to capture the Santa Isabel. Our next guest will be bringing back Itsmyluckyday off a lengthy injury-induced layoff for this afternoon's Gulfstream Park Handicap. We welcome in live via telephone Mr. Eddie Plesa. Eddie, Mark Casano welcoming you back to Down the Stretch.
Mark, always a pleasure.
Eddie, it's nice to have you back. It's nice to have Itsmyluckyday back as our audience watches him run second in last year's Preakness. And for our audience, he is number 9 in here. Eddie, we haven't seen him on the racetrack since he was vanned off following the Pegasus last June at Monmouth. Remind us, what happened to Itsmyluckyday?
He cracked his pelvis, which is not, it happens occasionally with horses, not very often, but I have had experience with other horses doing the same thing. And it requires a lengthy recuperation period. For him, he was in the stall, never left the stall for 4 months. And then after that, you start slowly to get him up to where he is today. So it was a lengthy rehab. Yeah, but he came out of it 110%.
Eddie, that sounds like a serious injury. I mean, was there a point during his recovery process that you thought to yourself, he might not make it back?
No, never. I've had other horses that have had the same injury, and my experience has been they come back 100%. Again, what causes that? Horses are going 30 plus miles an hour, and they can take a bad step, and evidently that was something that happened in this particular race. But it's a fracture, and fractures heal. It's a big bone. It's a big section. And again, my experience has been I haven't had any, knock on wood, that haven't come back to run and run to their full potential. Mike Smith did an outstanding job recognizing that something had happened. A less experienced jockey might have, when he took a little bit of a bad step, instead of pulling him up immediately, might have just asked him, tapped him on the shoulder and made him run off a little bit farther. And then that could have been catastrophic. Mm-hmm. But in this particular case, he's 100%. We're very anxious to see him back. We used a lot of self-control, and again, we just wanted it to happen when it was the right time for him.
Eddie, how much has Itsmyluckyday changed physically, mentally, from 3 to 4?
Well, he's certainly gotten bigger. He's a stronger horse. Horses do get bigger and stronger from the time frame that we're talking about. As far as the way he acts around the barn, he acts almost identical. I mean, he's the kind of horse when he's in the stall, you can play with him, you can do whatever you want with him. I mean, he's very docile and loves attention and stuff like that. But when you take him out of the stall, if you just want to give him a turn around the shed row, you better get tied on because he's ready to roll. I mean, he's just a handful. And on the racetrack, he's a good feeling horse. So you can certainly pick him out from the other horses on the racetrack. Has he changed physically? Yes. Mentally, he seemed to stay about the same. Again, we're coming into a race that's a very, very tough race. I really didn't have any other options of where to running him because he doesn't have any conditions. And this race came up at the right time. But make no bones about it. There's more horses in this race besides Itsmyluckyday and Palace Malice to think about.
Eddie, realistically, I mean, as you just said, this is one tough spot to come back off a lengthy layoff. Realistically, what do you expect from him this afternoon?
Listen, he loves the distance. He loves the surface. He's training great, but he hasn't run since June. So with that being said, he's going to give a great accounting of himself because he's training that good. Does he have a license to get tired and come up a little bit short? Absolutely. Would it surprise me if he did? No. Would it surprise me if he went on and won the race? Not really. I mean, this is a quality horse, no ifs, ands, or buts. And I truly believe the best is in front of him.
Well, Eddie, we are absolutely thrilled that It's My Lucky Day is back to the races. We're so pleased to have had you this morning once again on Down the Stretch, and we wish you all the best later this afternoon in the Gulfstream Park Handicap.
Thank you. Always a pleasure, and good luck to all your listeners.
Thank you, Eddie. Eddie Plesa, ladies and gentlemen, and this is some comeback, and it'll be fascinating to see how he runs against this very good field later this afternoon in the Gulfstream Park Handicap. And we are up to our next break. When we return, Mr. Mark Casse will join us as we go to the break, the grassy Palm Beach for three-year-olds. Some of these horses are going to be pointing for the July 5th, what is it, Belmont Derby Invitational? I don't like the name of the race, but I like the purse, $1.25 million. The 5-2 favorite in the Palm Beach, number one, Storming Inti. So we will take a look at the Palm Beach to the break. Back with Mark Casse right after these messages.
And they're all in line. They're racing in the Palm Beach. Smart Cover bobbled a bit coming out of there. My Stormtrooper goes out to the front with Storming Inti on the inside, and Gala Ward is sent along with them. It's going to be Storming Inti to make the pace. My Stormtrooper running in second. Gala Ward is third, and then Pluven to the outside of Patent as they race for the turn. Break of another two, and then Morning Calm to the outside of So Lonesome, who saves ground 6 lengths off the lead. 2 lengths more back to Can't Help Believing, and then toward the inside it's Smart Cover. After that, Cabo Cat, followed by Two Jacks Wild and Mr. Speaker is dead last early, 13 off the lead, 23-4 was the first quarter. Storming Inti leads the way, 3/4 of a length over My Stormtrooper. Gala Ward is third to the outside by two, and then Patent and Pluven. 2 lengths more back to So Lonesome. Mr. Speaker's moving now. Mr. Speaker, who was dead last moving onto the backstretch, has pulled his way up into mid-pack now, just 5 lengths off the lead and racing at the rail. Then Can't Help Believing, followed by Morning Calm, Cabo Cat, Smart Cover to the inside, and Two Jacks Wild. 48-1 was the half mile. They're moving into the far turn. And it is Storming Inti in front. My Stormtrooper ridden along. Gala Ward on the outside of them. Break of another two to Pluven. And then it's Patent. Mr. Speaker with 5 lengths to make up just in behind the leaders. Now got to switch to the far outside. They're into the stretch. Storming Inti off the turn in front. On the outside, Gala Ward. Here's Pluven. Mr. Speaker trying to put in a late run on the far outside, lugging in, but he's coming. Storming Inti in front. Gala Ward. Mr. Speaker on the far outside. Pluven, here's the wire. Gala Award has won. From Mr. Speaker, Storming Inti and Pluven.
This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Funding your Capital OTB bet account is as easy as 1, 2, 3. 1, easy money. Clearly the fastest and easiest method of depositing funds into your account. Make deposits or withdrawals in just minutes. 2, Green Dot Money Pack. Gives you instant access to your funds. Green Dot Money Packs are available at thousands of retailers nationwide. And 3, MasterCard Visa. Simply click on the link from the funding page, enter your account information, and fund your account. CapitalOTBBet.com. Log on today.
Welcome back to Down the Stretch, everyone. I'm Mark Asano. My thanks to Eddie Plesa once again for having joined us. And Gala Ward for Todd and Johnny, from a maiden to a victory in the Palm Beach by a half over Mr. Speaker. Our next guest has a busy afternoon in front of him with Conquest Titan and Matador in the Tampa Bay Derby and Uncaptured in the Gulfstream Park Handicap. Joining us from the Ocala Breeders Sales this morning, Mr. Mark Casse. Mark Casano, welcoming you back to Down the Stretch.
Thank you, Mark.
Always nice to have you. All right, let's begin with Conquest Titan. And as our audience watches his two-year-old finale last November in this Churchill allowance, for our audience, he's last at the top of your screen en route to beating General A-Rod. Mark, let's talk about his change in running style. In his earlier races, including the Breeders' Cup Juvenile, he showed early speed, actually making the lead in several of those races. But in his last two starts, including this one, he came from the clouds. What's up with that?
Well, you know what, Mark? We felt all along that he was a very talented horse, but we just didn't feel like we were getting 100% out of him. So after his performance in the Breeders' Cup, we decided we needed to make some type of change. So as you saw in the race at Churchill Downs, we decided to take him back and trying to make, you know, make a big run with him. And it worked. And now in the Holy Bull, we didn't intend to be as far back as we were, but he kind of got squeezed at the start. And so the next thing you knew, Sean looked up and he was dead last. But it wasn't ideal. But, you know, we're hoping today. I don't necessarily believe that he has to be, you know, dead last or really far back out of it. But, you know, we're going to let him settle and hopefully come running.
Well, we're going to take a look at a piece of the Holy Bull in a moment. But for now, Mark, we're going to have a shot of him on the screen for our audience. Would you please take a moment to describe him from a physical standpoint for our audience?
You know what? He's just kind of a medium-sized type of horse. He's a lot like his dad. But he has one of the quickest turns of foot of maybe any horse I've ever trained. When you ask him to go, he can accelerate quickly. And, you know, he's a pretty horse. I mean, would you pick him out of a pack? Maybe not, you know, but he's a beautiful moving horse when he runs. And, you know, so we'll just see.
We are going to take a look at a piece of his three-year-old debut in the Holy Bull, which may prove to be a very key race. He's going to come from last to get second. He's just entering the screen, rallying for our audience. Mark, you talked briefly about this earlier. This is a pretty solid second to a very good three-year-old.
Well, you know what? I think when you watch him run, you know, he's running by horses. And they're not average horses. These, you know, this is a tough race. There was a good group of horses. He ran by, you know, all but one, and then of course to make things a little better, Intense Holiday came back and won the Risen Star. So he's been, you know, spending time with him. He's been running against a decent group of horses. So it's not like he's running with second class citizens.
That's right. Now, he's the son of Birdstone, who himself won at a mile and a quarter, won at a mile and a half. But, Mark, so many deep closers, one-run closing horses, actually prefer middle distances to when they stretch out to routes. What's your opinion on Conquest Titan? As the races get longer, will he be able to sustain that kick?
You know, Mark, honestly, you just don't know. You look at his pedigree and you say he should. You look at his running style, you say he should. But honestly, if I sit here and told you I'm not worried, you know, you always worry until you see a horse do it. So you just never know, and I agree with you. Sometimes those horses are better middle distance horses. But, you know, I thought his first race around two turns was very good, and hopefully he builds on that. He's trained really well going into it. And, you know, again, the proof will be in the pudding. I hope I like the taste of it.
Now, following the Holy Bull, you mentioned the Fountain of Youth, and you skipped that. Then you mentioned Waiting for the Florida Derby. Here he is in the Tampa Bay Derby. Why the change, and why that decision to go to Tampa?
Well, I was concerned, one, you know, I thought, he's like I told you, he's not a huge horse. He lost a little weight after the Holy Bull. And we looked at the Fountain of Youth for a little bit, but watching the races, you know, it's just so hard to win down there from coming from off of it. So then I said, well, I'm not gonna run in the Fountain of Youth. And actually, Fountain of Youth Day, we breezed him, and he breezed so good. And I said, do I really want to wait, you know, wait 6 weeks and go to the Florida Derby and run on a biased racetrack? And so then we started looking for alternatives, and That's how he came up with the Tampa Bay Derby.
Mark, I noticed in the racing form a two-week break in workouts from February 8th to February 22nd. Any problem?
No, not really. Again, like I said to you, we just decided that we wanted to put a few pounds on him. So he missed one middle work. But, you know, now he's come back and had two nice works. And so, no, we're good.
You're also going to run Matador this afternoon in the Tampa Bay Derby, a close fourth in the Sam Davis in his three-year-old debut and last. For our audience, as we pick it up, he's last at the top of the screen. Mark, talk to us about Matador.
Well, Matador ran a big race because, one, it was his first try on dirt. Second, he hadn't ran in 3 months. And I don't know if you can see it, but he actually got hit over the top of his nose at the top of the lane by Asserting Bear, the rider of Asserting Bear, to Rocco. Matador was moving towards the lead, and all once you'll see him throw his head. And the reason he did that was he got hit over the bridge of his nose. So I don't know how much that affected him, but it couldn't help him. So we'll see.
This was his first start since last November. Now today's Tampa Bay Derby is a tougher spot than the Sam Davis, but do you expect him to move forward off this effort?
Well, I would hope so. You know, of course, he's got a race over the track. He's not coming off with such a big layoff. And again, remember, he's only ran one time on the dirt. So you would think all those factors, you know, that he would move forward and run better. But as you know, in horse racing, you never know.
One final question before we let you go. You'll be running Uncaptured this afternoon in the Gulfstream Park Handicap, a tough race. The good news is Lee isn't there. How's Uncaptured doing?
That's a really good news. You know, I thought his last race was decent. I thought if Lee hadn't been in the race, press me, that he would have even ran better. You know, he likes a mile. He's got a couple of races at Gulfstream. I think he'll have a little better speed now coming off that last race. And we'll see. We're anxious to get him back to Churchill Downs. He loves it there. But in the meantime, we needed a place to go, and this one seemed to make the most sense.
Mark, as always, thank you for your time. Thanks so much for having joined us this morning on Down the Stretch. All the best with Conquest Titan and Matador at Tampa. All the best with Uncaptured at Gulfstream. And we'll look forward to speaking with you again very soon.
Thank you, Mark. Have a great day.
Thank you. Bye. You too. Mark Casse, ladies and gentlemen. And we are up to our final break. When we return back to Southern California for Kathy Ritvo. As we go to the break, last Sunday's Here Comes the Bride for three-year-old fillies on the grass at Gulfstream, the 9-5 favorite, number 2, Candy Kitty. So we'll take a look at the Here Comes the Bride to the break. Back with Kathy Ritvo right after these messages.
They're all in line. They're racing in the Here Comes the Bride, and High Wire Kitten was a step slow to get going. It is Seeking Her Glory out for the lead. Raging Atlantic on the outside and Hartley on the far outside. These three go at it early. Mary Mary B away in fourth, and then comes Candy Kitty, who settles into position fifth on the inside and is moving up along the rail to get close to the pace. Tightly packed the first five. Val Suz in behind them running in sixth. America seventh. Then High Wire Kitten to the outside and Room Service trails, racing 8 lengths off of Seeking Her Glory and Javier Castellano. They went 23-4 for the opening quarter mile. They lead by a length and a half. Raging Atlantic is running in second. Candy Kitty neatly placed third to the inside, right alongside of Hartley, and in behind them is Mary Mary B. America is next on the far outside, 4.5 lengths off the lead. Then Val Suz along the rail. High Wire Kitten and Room Service continues to race at the back, 47-4 for a half mile. Seeking Her Glory on top by a length and a half. Raging Atlantic hardly on the outside. At the rail, it's Candy Kitty in fourth. America follows in fifth. After that, it's Mary Mary B, Valseuse. Now, room service begins to roll on the far outside. Room service going by horses quickly now as they come toward the top of the stretch, seeking her glory, Raging Atlantic. And here comes Candy Kitty up to them. Room service continues to knock on the door, fourth on the far outside, and they're into the stretch. And it's Seeking Her Glory, Candy Kitty, room service on the far outside. Candy Kitty to the front. Room service on the outside runs on. Seeking Her Glory battles on. Room service and Candy Kitty. Room service pulling away. Room service and the Here Comes the Bride over Candy Kitty, Seeking Her Glory and Valseuse.
This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Wagering at CapitalOTBBet.com is as easy as 1, 2, 3. 1. Capital Bet TV, the fastest and easiest online wagering experience where you can monitor 5 different tracks simultaneously. 2. Capital Bet Express, its straightforward program layout and interactive handicapping information lets you build your wager quickly and efficiently. And 3. Capital Bet Pro, designed especially for the professional horse player. CapitalOTBBet.com. Log on today.
Welcome back to Down the Stretch, everyone. I'm Mark Cassano. My thanks to Mark Casse once again for having joined us. In room service, Wayne Catalano, Joel Rosario, impressively rallies to a 2-length victory over Candy Kitty to win the Here Comes the Bride. Final guest this morning has returned to the site of her biggest victory, not to mention the biggest victory for Mucho Macho Man, joining us live via telephone from Santa Anita, Kathy Ritvo. Kathy, Mark Cassano, welcoming you back to Down the Stretch.
Thank you. Good morning.
Always nice to have you. So how are you and Macho doing back in Southern California?
Fantastic. Everything's going very well.
Well, we are going to go back and take a look at a piece of Mucho's 2014 debut in the Sunshine Millions Classic. As we pick it up for our audience, he will be stalking in second. Kathy, talk about this effort, if you would.
It was a great day. I mean, the weather was fantastic. He broke real well. Gary let him run a little, and then he kind of stalked the horse in front, and just, when it was time, he just blew right by him, and we had a happy horse that day.
Kathy, he's about to win off by 14 without a great deal of urging from Gary Stevens. Did he get enough out of that race and his subsequent works to be primed for today's big cap?
Yes, definitely. I mean, this horse doesn't need a lot of work. He kind of, you know, we let him basically do what he wants to do when he works. He has a lot of two-mile gallops, if you'd ever come out and watch him. He jogs a mile the wrong way, and then he starts his gallop. He gallops long gallops, and that seems to do it for him. And he stays fit. It's just the way he is. He's a fantastic athlete.
Kathy, you guys bypassed the $10 million Dubai World Cup for today's $750,000 big cap. What factors went into that decision?
It would be harder on the horse to travel. We were just trying to do the right thing for the horse. You know, and he has a lot of fans here, and we just wanted to do the right thing for the horse. It would be better for him to stay here, and I'm just very glad that it worked out like this.
Kathy, the one thing we do know about Mucho is he really doesn't like wet racetracks. There's been quite a bit of rain recently in Southern California. Has that affected your training at all?
You know, we breezed on Sunday between the races, and the racetrack was good that day. It was drying out, and they did a great job on the racetrack. They just were a big help when we got ready to work in between the fourth and fifth race. But like I said, the racetrack was good, so you know, we just kind of let him plod along. He was off the rail, and the racetrack was heavy. I wouldn't have ran him on a racetrack like that day, so I wanted just to let him, you know, work on his own and then gallop out. And he went really well. He did exactly what I wanted him to do, except he was looking around. There was something at the quarter pole on the turf course, like a something pink or red, my rider said, that he was looking at. So, you know, it distracted him a little, but he got plenty out of it. He was ready when we got here.
The Big Cap is being billed as a rematch of the Breeders' Cup Classic between Mucho and Will Take Charge and Game On Dude. But you know, Kathy, there's something quite a bit different as far as the race setup. In last year's Breeders' Cup Classic, there was enough speed to not only entertain Game On Dude on the front end, but to prevent him from making the front end. Today, there's not that much speed in here. Are you going to have to do more of the dirty work, and have you and Gary discussed strategy?
No, Gary's going to be able to, you know, handle it. He knows what to do. You know, and the fact that Game On Dude has so much speed, he's a very nice horse, but we were in front of him, you know. So whatever Gary has to do, I'm sure he'll do.
So on a scale of 0 to 10, 10 being as good as he could be doing, how's Mucho Macho Man doing coming into the Big Cap?
A definite 10.
Kathy, as always, we appreciate your time. Thank you so much for having joined us this morning on Down the Stretch, and all the best with Mucho later on in the Big Cap.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Kathy. Kathy Ritvo, ladies and gentlemen. To me, the most fascinating thing, listen, there are several differences, obvious differences, between the Breeders' Cup Classic and this afternoon's Santa Anita Handicap, the purse, the number of horses, but the likely pace scenario. Now, Game On Dude is coming off the worst race I've seen him run in a long time, but he is a quality enough horse, if left alone on the front, can be very, very scary. And where last year you had speed that took away his ability to get into a rhythm and to be in front, I don't see any other speed this afternoon. So I think Mucho's got to keep him company. Gary Stevens knows Game On Dude is a quality racehorse, particularly when left alone. Can Mucho Macho Man, off one race, that romp in the Sunshine Millions Classic against nothing, if he has to do the dirty work, can he do that and hold off the late charge of Will Take Charge? I think it's going to be a beauty later this afternoon in the Big Cap. All right, time to wrap things up for this very, very busy March 8th edition of the show. Time to thank all the folks who helped get this week's show on the air. Here at the studios at the Clubhouse Racebook in Albany, our associate producer Julie Hoxie, Brian DiRenzo, and Mick Richards. Back in the control room in Schenectady, Pat Peretta directed, and I think Pete Persico did audio. And thanks to this morning's four guests from Southern California, Kathy Ritvo and Art Sherman, and from South Florida, Mark Casse and Eddie Plesa. What a wonderful day of racing, with the numerous stakes races headed by the Big Cap and the San Felipe at Santa Anita. The Gulfstream Park Handicap is a beauty in South Florida. So ladies and gentlemen, enjoy all the great racing action this weekend from coast to coast here at Capital. Have a wonderful upcoming week. And from all of us here at Down the Stretch, we'll see you next week.
You're watching OTB TV, a service of Capital Off-Track Betting.